So I'm standing in front of the Greyhound station, and this is a place where a lot of people from across the country, this is their first stop when they're coming to Hollywood to pursue their dream. And so when I first met Sajan, I was immediately interested in him because I said, why is this guy so enthusiastic about his career? After getting to know him a bit, I later became inspired by him, and I realized that he had found something that made him truly happy. And I said to myself, I said, you know what, at the end of the day, it really doesn't matter. You know, it's okay to follow your dreams. Because we all want to feel that sense of accomplishment, rewards, and we all want that pat on the back to say a job well done. So in the end, we just all want to be happy.
This is one of the hardest things in the world to accomplish, and I will accomplish my goals because I'm determined and I love doing what I do. And a lot of people talk the talk. I'll walk it.
You know, trying to make it out here in Hollywood, you know, it's trials and tribulations, and it's a dog-eat-dog world, man. Out here, it's even worse, you know, because everybody wants that job.
So, I'm here in fabulous Hollywood, just trying to be all that I can be. And boy, has it been something else down here. I really do feel like I'm the black eyed love Lucy. I came out here because I wanted to pursue the industry and had a great opportunity. And of course, as soon as I get out here, the person who invited me out here passes away.
So, after you, prepare your breakfast. Do you pray?
No. Does that look like a pancake to you?
So every actor in Hollywood wants to be on a regimen where they work out.
It's like burns like the fat or whatever, how they say it, the anger.
The excess that you don't need. No one wants to be with the fat guy.
Stayed over here, stayed over there. It's just been a struggle. It's like I feel like I've been on tour, just trying to get a good foundation as I'm pursuing myself in the industry.
Well, you know, the struggle for me has been basically the money. You know, try getting paid as an actor out here. It's almost impossible to get any money out of these producers because most of these guys don't have any money to begin with.
No, I got a really good deal going right here. You know, gets me some cash. So I can chase the dream as an actor. Most of all your salespeople are coming out of Los Angeles selling toner. They're all in the valley. It's like porn. Basically, I'll have these cards. These are Dun & Bradstreet cards, and I'll cold call offices up and try to get the model numbers to their copy machines. I'll go in creatively, saying, hi, this is John for the photocopier. I'm sending out the updated manual for your copy machine. I need to get the 3 or 4 digit model numbers right on the front. It's a quick yes or no. Okay. Got the accounts payable department.
So what just happened to you?
Oh, I got a voicemail. Hi, this is John for the photocopier. Hi, I'm sending the updated manual out. Yeah, hi, this is John for the photocopier. Yeah, hi, this is John. Hi, this is John. Yeah, hi there, this is John. Yeah, hi, this is John. Yeah, it's John. Hi, I'm sending the updated manual out. On the front, the updated manual. Yeah, hi, Brenda. Brenda? Yeah, the new one. Hi, Brenda, this is John. 3 or 4 digit model number. Accounts payable, they know who I am. It's the big one. Okay, I'm talking about the big machine. Are you near the machine? I'm for the photocopier. And I need to get the 3 or 4 digit model number.
And that's the ID number.
It's the one by the receptionary next to you.
The one that only makes copies of the receptionary. You can get that. Appreciate that, Brenda.
Oh, I'm sorry. Am I calling? Where am I calling? This is John.
Yeah, that's the one. Who's in charge of the machine so I can send that to? To Kim? And what's Kim's last name? Nurse extension? All right, she's the one in charge of ordering supplies, right? You're a sweetheart. You have a good day, okay? Bye.
I've made $5.
Hi there, this is John for the photocopier.
Auditioning November 20th. Saddam Hussein male on male 38.
That's something I can play.
Do you think it'd be a weatherman, the hob manager at a hotel, or oh no, that's me, an attendant.
Unbelievable. Lots of the actors in the town.
So I think I'm pretty much young to be an attendant in my 30s. See, there I am. So I'll submit. I'm getting new pictures in a month because of aging. So now that I know that I submit electronically, what I'll do is I will. What I will do is mail a hard copy to her, which she knows who I am. Kim Harden. Been doing this for what, 4 years every day, 7 to 5 days a week. A lot of these casting directors, they say everything's done over the internet. This is true, but they always want a hard copy. And this is what actors won't do right here. A majority, not all, a majority. Okay? And even if there wasn't nothing for me in this picture, I'd put for like day player or something. Just so she knows I'm out there. Okay?
So how much would you say you spend in a month doing this?
Well, easy. Pictures, envelopes, everything? 300, 200 a month. This is all I got right now.
And you've been doing this for how long now?
4 years.
7 days.
Yeah, 4 years. Every day.
Checking the submissions every day.
Every day. I mailed out 80 pictures last week. And then this is what I do. I like to date it. And then I'll put the year. Because one day when I get there. Okay, so here it is. This Christmas. Okay, and I will be the attendant. It says right here. Attendant. He's an attendant in a Christmas tree lot. One line, one scene. I'm an attendant. And I won't even get that. But if I don't keep saying, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here, I'm here. Yeah. So we submit electronically for the attendant. And also, hard copy. Okay? So we go to the next one. This is since January. January, I mailed out 140 pictures. I would have mailed out a lot more, but I was at Sundance for 2 weeks. And I got a ticket for passing out a flyer at Sundance. There's me with my ticket right there at Sundance. It took a picture of me. They wrote me a ticket. Look at that. I was in a suit and tie, AJ. Give me that shit. Sundance is basically, it's where all the producers, directors, you know, movers and shakers, they go.
Actors,
independent filmmakers, they go up there and they display their stuff. You know, get their films in there.
And so it's you just went out there.
Oh, that's my second year going out there.
Pitching
on the street like a gorilla. You know. Yeah, so there I am. This girl saw me pitching on the street, and she came up to me, and she goes, so why are you down here? And I'm like, well, I'm down here because I had to get myself in front of as many, you know, directors, producers, so they know who I am. So, I mean, if you read the article, amidst the star filmmakers and patrons of the Sundance Film Festival, Sage and Corona stands on a busy street corner handing out photos. I wasn't handing out, I'm pitching, so let's just correct that, of himself. This is what you got to do in the industry. You have to hustle. You have to hustle, Corona says. He hands out pictures to a group of people walking by, shouts, watch, you're going to be doing Leno. I'm going to be doing Leno someday. Most people in this town do not want to do this homework.
Now, what type of flyer was this?
This is basically, it's a pitch. It's a 4x5 pitch. 4x5 pitch is something that you're in a movie. I'm in this movie called Getting It. I'm in it for probably 13 minutes. And basically, this enables me to pitch myself. So when I meet with people, I just give them that. That's my pitch.
My network is actors, because we like to network. A lot of them stabbing each other in the back. Everyone stabs each other in the back of this town.
Yeah.
Go to my website, check out my reel. So, how long have you been chasing the dream?
I'm not really actively chasing it, though. I have an agent, and you know, if it goes well, it goes well.
Alright, now I'm at the post office, and what I'm doing is mailing out pictures to everything that's literally in Hollywood that's being casted. And as an actor, if you're not doing it every day, 5 days a week, 12, 15 hour days, it ain't gonna happen. So I've been doing this for 4 years, probably mailed about 15,000 to 20,000 pictures out.
Saging has been coming to us for 4 years now, every day.
Every day?
Monday through Friday.
Saturdays?
Friday.
Yeah, Saturdays.
Yeah. But I don't mind seeing you come to see us every day.
Every day?
Faithfully, sometimes twice a day.
Twice a day?
Yeah.
How many pictures would you say I've mailed out in the last?
I can't count, but you spent the money. We appreciate you.
What I'm doing now is I'm going to my first down to LA. The reason why I come here is because of the deal I get. I get these pitch cards, which is about 5,000 for about $250. So You gotta have a pitch. Gotta have a pitch.
Peter Cottontail.
Okay, I'm doing a photo shoot on the 16th of December, and then I should have the photos a week after that. We're gonna do the same thing, a 4x5 pitch card.
Okay.
Somebody started a rumor saying I don't look like my pictures. What do you think?
Well, I think this still looks like you.
Am I a good looking guy, Peter? Would you sleep with me?
No, appreciate your business.
I know. And I'm gonna keep, you know, Tiffany was
the longer you don't get discovered, the more printing we do for you.
That's right. And you never know. You never know. You saw my reel, right?
Right.
What'd you think of it?
I thought it was pretty good. Yeah.
C+, B-, right?
Yeah, you're not. You're in the passing category.
Peter, how many actors are doing what I'm doing? What you see?
None.
Say that one more time.
None. Not like this. It's like almost like he's promoting a concert or something.
What am I doing, Gabe?
You might have other actors
hustling,
come in here
hustling
and print 1,000 postcards or something, but not like this guy.
But not like me. Remember when I did the drop? Remember the drops when I did the drop? You have never had an actor come in, had some kind of thing designed, pitched, where you're pitching like I am.
No.
How long have you been in the printing business for?
8 years.
You know I'm not going to jump off of building, right?
Well, I'm not sure about that.
You think I'm going to jump in front of a bus?
Could be. Could happen.
Here's one of the few things that I do at least twice a month. This is the 6th Street Bridge that goes into downtown Los Angeles. The most beautiful view of this bridge is really early in the morning when the sunrise is coming up. It keeps me to say, don't ever leave this city. Stay here till the end. I've never been to New York, and I kind of feel like this is my New York, driving in the skyline. And what makes me want to keep coming back is just one day driving over this bridge in a nice car. And this is your home, Sage, in Los Angeles. This is where you were born. This is where it's all going to happen for you. Because I chased my dream. It just keeps me going and not losing it and saying, am I crazy or what?
Casting process, you want to talk about the casting process. Talk about a nightmare going through the casting process. Oh my God. You know, just preparing to get there, having to deal with what you got to deal with once you're in there, and then you got people shitting all around you, talking. They're trying to kill your concentration so that you can't even for a minute figure out what you got to do.
About 3 years ago, I had gotten an audition from a casting director by the name of Patricia Rose, who gave me my really first part in a movie. You have to come around the back, but right where that palm tree behind those windows is where I had auditioned, and it was, you can hear everyone going in the audition, you can hear them talking, and I don't want to say that's unprofessional, but it's amazing how some actors weren't making a strong choice. And I knew that when I went in, I'm a security guard to get shot, and I went in there and I went, oh! And I guess she was impressed that I did that, and I dipped the whole blood coming out of my mouth.
The movies that I work on, I usually get a direct booking through networking in Hollywood. I've met a lot of producers and directors that have taken a liking to me, and someone sees something, and, you know, and then I get a shot in the movie. Usually it's a small part, but you know, I guess no part is too small. So I could be playing a bank robber, for instance, you know, and have some really cool dialogue, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, there could be a couple of really famous actors, and you know, here they are with a couple of guns, you know, and here I am taking the bullets, which we call here in Hollywood squibs.
This is the core, this is the heart, this is where it all goes down, Hollywood and Vine. This is the ultimate goal, to live here, the ultimate. This building is being converted into like condominium lofts, and the most amazing thing is my goal is to live in that building. There's gonna be a pool on top, and truly, as an actor, to one day be sitting on the top, smoking a cigarette, drinking a drink, overlooking the Capitol building into the Hollywood sign is pretty much the ultimate I've made it. Say, Dad, have I made it now? Do you accept me as your son now? A friend of mine asked me the other day, how much time do I give myself? And I said, when my heart stops. Never, ever, ever stop trying. matter what. Until my heart stops is when I'm going to give up. That's pretty much how much time I give myself. So if I die trying, at least I tried.
I just stayed over here, stayed over there. It's just been a struggle. It's like I feel like I've been on tour, just trying to get a good foundation as I'm pursuing myself in the industry. I've gotten mugged out here. You know, I'm originally from Philadelphia by way of New York, and I came all the way cross country to get knocked in the head. Isn't that fabulous? So, for the most part, like I said, it's been something else. I have my good times, I have my bad times. But you know, in it all, as long as I have God, He's my first person. So He's keeping me through everything that I've been through out here.
So I had this mental breakdown about 8 months ago, and I came out to the Venice Pier. I had a treatment get to a major production company, and they declined it because they said I was too green. So while I was driving out here, I started to cry inside the car. I was asking myself why I'm crying. So I started walking to the Venice Pier, and I started crying harder, and I was embarrassed, so I pulled my scarf down on my hat, on my head, and I was watching the sunset. And I heard this voice in my head, "You're learning how to fish." And I replied, "You're just a fucking voice in my head, go away." And I was looking at the sunset, and it said, or should I say the voice, "No matter how rich or how poor you are, my child, that sunset will always be the same." And I knew God exists because every time I say, "You're a voice in my head," stuff like that responds.
It's a stage of course, but we were best friends, and just, we grew up together, like just hanging out and everything, and he started to get into acting. I'm a landscaper, and I'm very successful at what I do. And I look down at him, and he's struggling, and he's having a hard time, and I'm helping out the best I can. And I see like his family, it's not much support, some here, some there. It's like he comes to me and asks me for help. I help out the best I can. And we've been hanging out on the weekends, like just like hanging out on the beach, bike riding, and you know, hanging out at the bars and talking, and then just trying to help him out the best I can. Just that it's a really tough business. The most important thing about life is just being successful and, you know, getting where you want to get in life. And he's almost there, but he's trying. And I'm going to be with him all the way until he makes it, all the way to Hollywood, all the way.
I believe that whatever he wants to do, whether it be an actor, whether it be whatever, being a janitor, whatever it is, that if that's what he wants to do, that he should pursue it, and I support it. And I know one thing about Kirk / Sajan, that he's going to make it. I hope and wish the very best. There's been times that he'll say something like, you know, when he makes it big, you know, he's going to forget about everybody.
Family,
or they're going to be jealous of me or whatever. And I say, you know what? None of us are going to be jealous. We want you to succeed. All of us want you to succeed. I tell you that he's got at least two of his brothers who have supported him quite a bit. So he's got good brothers. And I think he's got a good family.
My mom has helped me out from time to time. I mean, like a couple of times she had paid my rent. My mom is probably the biggest mental believer in me and anybody. And that's why I'm gonna make it, because I want her to live a good life. My mom helped me out with some money, and she said, "If your career doesn't go anywhere, I still believe in you." And I think that meant more to me than anything. Whether I was famous or not, my mom still believes in me. But I want her to enjoy the nice things of life. Have a nice condo, drive a BMW, enjoy fine foods. There's nothing wrong with that. I love my mom to death. More than my dad, unfortunately. I mean, I don't get along with my dad too much because he kind of steered me away from my career when I was younger. He said, "You're chasing a pipe dream." And my sister, she had made some comments a couple of months ago that really hurt me. That's it. She could cut it.
Your mom obviously supports you. Your brother obviously supports you. Now, we haven't heard anything about Dad. Dad obviously doesn't support you.
No. Nothing. Just, he's...
What does he think about this whole ordeal and this whole...
Like, you? Chasing my tail. Or, you know, doing something that's going to go nowhere with my life. No, a job that no one respects. He respected me more when I sold cars. I think the only way I'll have success with my father is financially. To him, success is money. To him, success is owning a house. To him, success is owning a business. You know, that's him. Well, you know, after when 9/11 happened, I was like, no way, I'm gonna chase my dream to the end. If I'm gonna die, I'm gonna die trying. You know, I'm not gonna die making Ford rich, selling Fords in the valley. So I said, well, if I'm gonna do it, might as well chase the dream where you can have all the casual sex you want when you get in. You know? I mean, extreme.
And all the money that you can possibly make.
This is the only business in the world. The only business in the world. You can have casual sex with any girls you want.
So how does that make you feel that he just turned on you and...
Because, you know, all my other brothers, there's five in my family. Two of my brothers are school teachers, one brother's a contractor. My sister, you know, she's a homemaker now. And I'm the black sheep. With my father, I felt being a middle child that I didn't get the attention that I wanted. And I guess that's probably the reason why I want to be an actor. So I can get accepted. People say, why did you choose to be an actor? So I said, I can have a relationship with my father.
So you're looking for that one day, just that final approval? How is that going to mend the relationship between you and your dad, and he's going to feel proud, and he's going to make you feel that you have this sense of accomplishment?
I guess in a stupid way, the money you can make in this business is beyond sick. And if I showed my dad, like, yeah, look at all this money I'm making, and look at this lifestyle. Like, my sister had brought up something like a month ago that really, really hit a niche with me. That, you know, she goes, what happens when you're 70, you don't have a house? That's my sister, it's my own blood. I think she saw me doing something that she doesn't have the liberty to do, or the freedom. You know, I mean, she's a year younger than me, and you know, I'm balls to the walls. I can do whatever I want. You know, I don't have a mortgage. I don't have a car note. I don't have health insurance. All I gotta do is pay my rent, cell phone, and gas.
So you think maybe it might be a little jealousy there?
Well, 100%. 100%.
Well, I tried to actually do comedy with him, and I thought that the best way for me to be a critic of his comedy if I took a course with him. So we took a course at West LA College, and the graduation part was we had to do stand-up on stage. I thought it would be a good avenue. I thought it would be a good structure for him. You know, he doesn't have the college preparation of acting and theater. So just a little bit more structure, day in, day out, going to the comedy places, I think that really helped him in developing his strength of perseverance and keep on trying, even though when you fail. Because it's really good when people are laughing, but you know, when you try new material or there's not a lot of people in the audience, it's a struggle at times. This is his life, and this is what he decided to do, so he's still doing it, and I'm still school teaching.
I see myself more as a comedic actor than a dramatic. For me, comedy's more easier. I feel more comfortable with it. If you're gonna chase a dream, 110%, give it all you got. And you have to have love and drive and perseverance. And you have to want it. Whether you wanna be a culinary cook, whether you wanna be the best mechanic, whether you wanna be the number one landscaper, or you wanna be truly a great actor, you have to want it. It's not gonna come to you, not gonna knock on your door, and they're not gonna give you a sitcom. You have to go chase it.
So I say to myself, do people chase the dream of Hollywood to fill the void because of all she offers? Money, fame, clothes, any desire you want. And when I look at Sajan, I say, he actually wants to take his rewards back home and get that hat on the back for his day. And in the end, does it really matter? No. I guess that's why those come to Hollywood and they admire their stars so much, because they are brave for taking risks and contemplating their dreams.
How you doing there, man? Tequila drink. You like tequila?
What's up, everybody? Here we are 1 year later on the famous Hollywood Boulevard, checking out the stars, following up on our actors, Sajan Corona, Sister Boom Bam, and Oliver, who couldn't be available for comment. But we heard Sajan Corona has a lot of good things going on, landed a movie. Sister Boom Bam, she has some action happening with her. Let's check it out.
Hey, guys. Let me tell you, this is Sister Boom Bam. I'm going to let you know what's happening in the latest with me. First of all, I went down to Project Magic. I drove down to Vegas, and I had a great time there. It was like about a week or so, like 3 or 4 days. And what I did there was to look at all the latest fashion and hip-hop. And everybody came down, as far as Jay-Z and everybody in the game of hip-hop, to show their clothing line. It's just a party like a rock star. So now I'm about to dress for Mercedes-Benz, and I'm really, really looking forward to this. I was asked a couple of years straight, so now they want me back, so that's a really, really good thing. I'll be dressing for Peter Roth, which is Birds of Prey. It's his show. Usually I assist Jeffrey Wells. He asked me to come to help dress some of the models. Ideally, I would like to shoot a print ad with Essence Magazine or Elle Magazine, whichever one wants to call. And I also would like to host a show for MTV or VH1 and possibly go on tour with a major recording artist in rock or hip hop.
We're following up on Sajan Corona. We're going to find out what's happening with him 1 year later. He has a photo shoot. We heard he had a movie called Getting It. It's in Blockbuster. Let's go check it out. One year later. Hey. What's up, buddy?
How you doing, man?
I'm good, and you?
It's been about a year, huh?
Yeah. Wow. So what's happening now?
Doing a photo shoot, you know, just reinventing myself, constantly, you know, showing, casting, producing what I'm about.
And then we heard you had a movie in Blockbuster, right?
Yeah. Remember a year ago? Getting It finally got released.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. We need more of that.
That's right.
It got released through Blockbuster, Netflix, Hollywood Video, and Amazon. And it's exciting. And the distribution is really what gives you credibility in this town.
That's it. Good.
So what are you doing now? What is this whole process?
Doing new headshots.
Yeah, that's a perfect fit.
To let directors, producers.
No.
That I'm going to be the number one comedic actor in Hollywood. Yeah. The basic plot of the movie is this kid goes out, he buys these condoms, he's trying to lose his virginity, and they're huge, and they're the wrong size, he's embarrassed. He throws them in the toilet, they don't flush, his mom finds it, she thinks her son's got a huge schlong, she spreads a rumor, and I'm the Mexican cook.
So here we are with Sajan's acting coach, Miss Amy Linden.
Yes.
Right.
I've been teaching for 16 years.
Wow.
I stopped managing about 5 or 6 years ago because I'd rather teach. You're more like a grandmother. They go home. Masioka, who's on Heroes, he's one of my students. I'm also a filmmaker, writer, director. I have a film called Odessa, starring the late Yolanda King, and it won awards on the festival circuit, and it's a beautiful film. And I'm just starting a new clothing line called I Am Enough Mantra Wear.
There it is. Sajan Corona.
getting it. There's only, both of them are rented out, so. Just want to tell you, it's a good thing. If you do this every day, balls to the walls, mail out pictures, you will have a movie on Blockbuster and I'm walking proof.
My name is John S. Robbins, and I am the author of The Actor's Survival Guide. I wrote this book to try to help young actors who come to Hollywood and to get through the maze and all the scams that are in this town. I came to Los Angeles in the late 1970s to be an actor. I got my union card, I got an agent, and then I sat back and waited for the phone to ring, which it didn't do much. And I couldn't figure out what was I doing wrong. Well, where I was living was near where Ed Asner lived, and we used to jog together. And mostly we would make small talk, but one time I got up the nerve to ask him what he had done differently to get his big break on the Mary Tyler Moore Show. And he looked at me and he said, "I didn't do anything different. Hollywood is just one great big merry-go-round. The trick is to stay on. Everyone's going to get their shot at the gold ring. You just have to stay on the merry-go-round." Well, I kept trying, and two or three times I came this close to making it. Always something got in the way, and finally I said, "Enough, I've had it," and I gave up the dream. I went back to college, got my graduate degrees, and finally took a job as a teacher at a college up in Seattle. And as I was turning onto the freeway to leave Los Angeles, I started to cry. I couldn't figure out, why am I crying? I'm going to a wonderful new life. And I realized that even though I hadn't been pursuing my dream, I still in the back of my mind believed in it. But leaving Los Angeles meant I was giving up the dream. Well, I did go and I did teach, and I was teaching an advanced acting class. And one day a student said to me, "If you haven't done this in 20 years, how do we know you know what you're talking about?" And I thought about that. Of course, I got all puffed up, but then I realized he was right. I lack credibility. So I decided to take a year off as a sabbatical, come back to LA with my union card and some clothes, and see how far my advice would take me. Well, in that year, I had 68 auditions and booked 23 projects. And so when I came back to LA, I decided I would write this book to help other young actors. Well, I sat down and I made a list of actors that I had met that I thought were doing exactly what they should be doing to promote themselves. And Sage Corona was one of them. I had met him at a workshop, and the man was everywhere. I ran into him at auditions. I ran into him on the street, handing out pitch cards. He was promoting himself and doing everything that I wrote about in this book, telling other young actors what to do.
Can I just tell you, when Sage came to me, I knew I was going to be in for a huge ride. What Sage already has is the quotient of who he is and what he is selling. But if he wants to be able to play characters other than himself, I'm going to have to pull out the whip. I actually like somebody who's never trained anywhere before, which is why Sajan was a really great palette to work with. I just have to clean up his brain to think straight.
My name is Dwight Lay. I'm a producer, and I met Sajan via the IMDb, which is an internet database for people in the film business. As a producer, I met Sajan through that, and he saw that I was developing a couple of projects. I'm in the midst of getting a movie called The Hideout going. I think he saw that on the site, and he called me via my contact information and started asking me about that. And he asked me if I wanted to see his work, his reel, and I said, absolutely. Sajan basically had a lot of chutzpah, a lot of, you know, cojones, to use an expression he would probably use, just to call out of the blue. And I mean, a lot of people would just say, you know, "Go away, leave me alone." But I figured if anybody's got the nerve to actually call me and spend 5-10 minutes on the phone with me, I'm willing to listen to them.
Hi, I'm David. I am the editor that cut Sajan's demo reel. This is a marketing tool for an actor, which would go to casting directors, producers, directors. The reason a demo reel is important is that a headshot really only tells a casting director what you look like, whereas a demo reel shows you what you look like when you're moving and in a scene, and how your voice sounds and how you're acting. This is a scene from a movie Sajan was in, and normally the actor would provide me with footage. So what we do is we usually keep it pretty short because casting directors are very pressed for time, and just take the best, whatever the best material the actor has, and cut it together, and just try to keep it nice and short.
Silver, listen, we gotta change direction. You gotta start swimming with the bigger fish. Forget Sheila forever.
What are you talking about?
Grown women, ripe women, women that are experienced, that listen to their bodies, not their heart and shit.
I was very impressed by his reel. It was very brief. It was about a 3-minute reel, and it had a feature film called Getting It on it, and the other one was a television commercial. The one scene from Getting It that he has on his reel is him talking with his buddy in this kitchen scene, and they're basically talking about did his friend make it with this one lady that he recently met on a date, and Sajan's like really just kind of get the information out of the guy. He has to take a leak, but he didn't want to leave the room, so he just grabs a 5-gallon water jug and just starts peeing in the jug right on the spot. And I thought, now that's funny, you know, he just spontaneously did that, and that's good timing, and I don't think the director had to say much. He just had a natural sense about what was funny.
I see a lot of people with a lot of talent, like a supreme amount of talent, but they don't have any energy behind making it happen for themselves. You have to understand the business, and Sajan really understands the business. I teach my kids, or my students, I call them all my kids, how to build a business and how to book a job. It's sort of like dating, okay? It's like every time you go out to see a casting director or see a producer, you have to look at it like you're going out on a date. You don't want to give them everything on the first date. And you want them to come to you. You don't want to force yourself on them. So that's really how people need to look at the audition or the interview process. Like it's a date. What you want by the end of the interview is for them to ask you out for a drink.
What best piece of advice do you have for an actor right now who's in middle America thinking of moving to California, chase the dream of becoming a success?
Save a lot of money. Like thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. I wouldn't suggest doing theater out here. I would suggest becoming like a massive film whore.
My name is Nick Gaitages. I'm the director producer of Getting It. One of the characteristics that I admired in my actor Sajan Corona for Getting It was he's always been hopeful, always chasing the dream. So Sajan came to me as an actor for Northern audition through the breakdown services, I think. And I had about 300 guys for that part, for the part of Arturo. Sajan came in with such an energy and positive energy and confidence that once he auditioned for me, I hired him on the spot. I did not want to see anybody else. Well, I don't know if he knew that. I don't know if he was aware of that. Auditions are very important. He came somehow prepared. He came and he blew me away. It was his first film. he was not aware of certain technicalities or certain, I would say, protocol. To give you an example, we have a scene and in the car, and he's arguing with me. And I'm saying to Sajan, you know, thank God by that point I knew who Sajan was. Otherwise, if it was the first day of the shoot, I would say to Sajan, take a hike. Take a hike, baby doll. But no, I knew by then who Sajan was, so I let him say whatever he wanted to say, and he did. And he completed the shoot, and he did a good job. I was quite impressed that, you know, he was positive, he would follow direction, he would be on set on time, and he would be a real professional. I'm glad that I cast him in my film. I learned from him, and I hope he learned from me. It was a positive experience, and I do believe that chasing the dream, believing in himself, not listen to negative people around him, having positive energy, and just go and audition. You just don't know what you're going to audition for. You just don't know. A lot of times actors, they see a little casting notice. It's not a big studio. It's not, you know, a $30 million film. It's an obscure independent company that making a feature film. Hey, you just don't know where that film is going to go. Like getting it. Sajan, you know, has been appreciative of that. He calls me once in a while to thank me. Not thank me. I mean, he did what he's supposed to do. What he's supposed to do. Chase the goddamn dream. Very simple. Be positive. It happens. You know, to dream is not an easy thing. To go out there and work a 9-to-5 job in a bank, you can do it. Go in a restaurant. To be an actor, it's not an easy thing. Be pursuing a dream to be a successful actor, it's not an easy thing. It takes guts, takes belief, takes, I'm not going to say it, balls, let me say it. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Keep it going, baby.
You want fame. Well, fame costs. And right here is where you start paying and sweating. I remember those words from the movie Fame, and I never really knew what they meant until now. I highly recommend those hopefuls out there to go see the movie. You see, there's really no formula, no magic potion to making it in the entertainment industry. And if it was, I'd be selling it on eBay. But these artists, they have a passion that runs so deep that they're willing to go through the challenges. And the bottom line is, they all want their voices to be heard. Me, I'ma stick to singing in the shower.
So, this is the famous Sunset Boulevard, where a lot of groups start out, you know, they play at these venues. And so now we're on our next venture to find groups. You know, what really makes a group that you want to go out and buy records, you know, you want to go spend all kinds of money on their concerts. And that's what we're here to find now. Getting some sort of sense of gypsies, tramps. pimps. This is what came to me, so I don't know where the hell we're going to find a gypsy tramp and a pimp, but let's start out on Melrose. Let's go see if we see. This might be the location for them, so let's see what we find. I mean, Melrose is always happening with exciting and creative people, so let's see what we'll find out here, you know? I don't see a gypsy. I don't see a tramp. I don't see no pimp either. There's not even nobody to ask. Here's a guy jogging. I don't know if he's going to stop to tell us, but you seen gypsies, tramps, and pimps? Excuse me. Do you know where we can find gypsies, tramps, and pimps? We've got a source. I think we just found where they are.
How's it going, man? How are you?
I'm good.
This is a GTP world right here. This is like the foundation of the tramp anyway. So this is where I work, you know. We're superstars, but you know, we haven't got that paycheck yet. I am the front man of Gypsies, Tramps, and Pimps. I'm the tramp. I am the singer, the crazy man, as everyone's starting to say, like the new wave George Clinton, Rick James, Prince, which blows me away, because it's like, wow, these are the men that I admired, and I still do.
I mean, now, is this, you're all decked out, you're all dressed like
am
you
I?
Just stepped out of a music video or something.
That's funny.
I mean,
funny.
Now, is this normal, or is this,
and here I thought I was being conservative.
This place, this store, I mean, what is this place?
Well, this is rock style. This is like, we dress like vintage rockers, new rockers, but as far as what I have on, I thought I was being conservative.
So
I mean, this is just me. Yeah, I just wake up and like, oh, this, and this. Oh, here it is. I figured on my journey to the top of the music charts, if I'm going to work, I need to be surrounded by the environment that I want to be in. And of course, that's the rock, the funk, the R&B world. So I work here. We specialize, well, we started off selling memorabilia, like signed by the celebrities. And then Shelly, who owns Rockstyle, thought it would be cool to throw a clothing line into the mix just to see what happened. So she started out with basically signature t-shirts, like our Rockstyle t-shirt. And we had a Rockstyle t-shirt and leopard print hats. And Anthony Kiedis of Red Hot Chili Peppers wore the leopard print hat on the cover of Rolling Stone 2 weeks after we opened last year. And it was a wrap after that. And it's funny because Gypsy, that's in the group, also designed some of the clothes that are in the store too.
Shit did I go to?
We're in the sweatshop. This shit is hot as hell. Southern California on the West Coast.
We pulling this across, you know what I'm saying? This is what you call silk screen, if y'all don't know. You know what I'm saying? We gets dirty around here. We do all our own shit.
Let's see what the result.
Damn, this is what we do, you know what I'm saying?
What you know about that?
This is my new shirt, my new band Princess. Watch it.
A one of a kind. Nobody can't duplicate that.
The music and fashion go hand in hand. You come in, I can spend 30, 40 minutes with you, and by the time you leave, it's like you're on your way to the American Music Awards. Because you can't be chasing chicks dressed like you just came off Wall Street. You know what I mean? If you're going to be out in the bar, you need to have them going from the time you walk in. Oh my, who's that? See, I have a shoe fetish, so ever since I was a baby, man, like my mom told me that I used to take my little, like when I learned to walk, I would take my little walking shoes and dip them in dye and just like make crazy colored shoes because I was obsessed with like Prince and Jimi Hendrix. The thing that separates our group from most, we're coming out the box doing something totally different in the music industry. We're three solo artists. We came together as a group, but we're releasing solo projects together. Like my album's coming first, the Liquor and Life album. But it's basically Glass and the GTP. And then comes Gypsy's album, and it's Gypsy and the GTP. And then it's Hollywood and GTP. But we're still Gypsy's, Tramps, and Pimps. Glass, aka the Tramp, and the rest of the crew. So this is what makes being in a rock store fun. Now, normally, yeah. See, normally, see, you couldn't get this at Macy's. You know, I got my personal, you know, keep my personal little things around.
Okay, we're on our way to find base camp for Gypsies, Tramps, and Pimps.
We're going to go into the world of these guys and see what it's like to be them. Okay.
All right, so now we're on our way. We're getting ready to go to base camp. Gypsies, tramps, and pimps.
Hey, how's it going?
Oh, what's up, man?
I told you we were coming.
Oh, man.
That's right.
You call me? Hey, more liquor in life.
How's it going?
Cruz here. Doing?
This is... Why don't you introduce yourself to the camera here?
Hollywood Bubble Eyes, you know what I'm saying? Just get kicking the life for y'all.
Yeah, y'all just called us, man. We were just in here just discussing our last show. The goodness, the controversy, the drama. The owner of CenterSpace called us personally when he called us last week just to say thank you for waking up a club that otherwise has been dead when it comes to live performances. And he just wanted to thank all of us because at first the first show we did, they said we were too vulgar. Then everybody else came and performed throughout the week, so they're just like, it's dead.
By the end of the show, everybody gets it. It is what it is. It's a music experience. And we try to send them on that journey. I don't know. Yeah, but Mr.
Because, you know, it pisses me off. And it enlightens me and pisses me off at the same time. Because isn't it amazing how the same people criticize us until they see us perform and then they come and bow down?
So if they don't understand that we come from a generation of performers and of people that had showmanship. You know what I mean? So they think, they look at us and how we dress and stuff like that. And that's cool. They know that's cool, but when they see us on stage, it just all comes together, and a lot of people don't get it until they see it. You know what I mean? They don't believe it until they see it. That's how it is.
This right here is called Liquor and Life. For everybody who drinks up. Man, drinks up. Every time I get drunk, I get stressed out. I'm good. But check this out. For everybody who got problems, drinks up. I'm all stressed out. This world's not right. Put me some liquor, let me tell you about life. Racial slurs, propaganda. She say, whole world slay down. Lord have mercy of Jesus Christ. We sin all day and wanna pray at night. We're asking God for the rain to come, but you get none. Sing with me. Damn, homie, I'm so cold. And I don't think I'm ever gonna smoke no more. And I don't think I'm ever gonna drink no more. Bartender, could you give me one more? Damn, homie, I'm so cold.
Drinking a little, you know, vodka and some what?
What's that, mist?
Mist?
Yeah,
it's hot. You ain't bothered to make me know?
Now, what's interesting is that how all you guys came together. This is, how did you all find each other?
I can honestly say magic.
I got introduced to Gypsy through one dude, Mashinda. And through him, I got introduced to Glass from Gypsy. And then they've known each other quite a bit of time, you know what I'm saying? Probably about 10, 20, 30, 40 years, you know, somewhere in between there, doing a fashion thing, you know, knocking that stuff out the box and everything. So me and Gypsy came together as doing music, and everything's just been hot ever since. And then, like I said, Gypsy introduced me to Glass, and when he introduced me to Glass, you know, 7707, that's when everything really started. That's where we really started cracking and making some hard music.
One day, the stars and the moons, like, they just collided, and they created this force, this centrifugal force that cannot be stopped, known as GTP, Gypsies, Tramps, and Pimps. That day just happened to be 7707, like Bubble Eyes Pimp just told y'all. When we met on that day, we came together, and we formed a bond, and we decided we were going to do something together, which was this project called Stained Glass World Project. And that's what we worked on, that's what we produced, that's what we helped Glass give birth to, you know what I mean? And that's where this camaraderie, that's where this bond comes from. But as far as when we met, I believe we met thousands upon thousands of years ago, you know what I mean? In a galaxy far, far away somewhere.
Basically, I met Gypsy a couple of years back during a fashion show. He was actually doing a fashion show, and I was bringing another model friend of mine to the show, and then I ended up just taking over because that's what I do. I just, you know, walk in the room that, you know, I'm a tramp. And for those who think tramp just means sleep your way to the top, tramp means totally ravishing, always mad passionate. See, there's a big thing. Of course, I will do anything to get to the top, but that's a whole nother episode. I had a vision in my mind before we came together of doing a project. And I had been in so many different bands. Some tried to throw me in the back because they're like, oh, you're still in the spotlight and it's my band. And I'm like, hey, I'm doing a job. I can only be me. And I guess it's hard to stop shine when you're standing next to the sun. I don't know. When you get a gypsy, a tramp, and a pimp, you know what you get? The best little whorehouse in Cali, because that's the album. And I'm good.
That's the forthcoming album.
That's the forthcoming album, The Best Little Whorehouse in Cali.
Gypsy was saying we gave birth to the project I was talking about, which is the Liquor and Life Project, which is my solo album, but it's still a group album. But then us three together, the best little whorehouse in Cali. And they're not ready. From Freak to Sugar Daddy to Underwater with Magazines, getting drunk, playing tambourines, playing stories. You know what I mean? That's how we do it.
Okay, what do you do during the day?
I do everything, man.
Yeah. He hot.
I'm hot, you know what I'm saying? From 9 to 5. Even when I'm asleep, I'm still hot. Fire's still burning.
I say this, in this era of oversized t-shirts, super fat chains, steel hat to the back, and everybody bragging about, I got diamonds, I got cars. The thing that we do that's different, when we're on stage, we invite the audience to come be with us. We don't flash what we have. We let people know, you can have a good time and love and delight just like we can. So come on stage if you want to, dance with us, party with us. And ladies, if you want to, come backstage and freak with us. We're not trying to brag about anything because we just are. We don't have to brag. You know what I mean? If all you need is a nice diamond ring and a big car to make you feel like a superstar, then good luck with that. We got the mind. We got the heart. More importantly, we got the talent.
We funk, man. We funk punk. You know what I mean? A little rock in there. A lot of Prince influence. A lot of, like you said, Rick James, Parliament. Sounds, man. We're into the sounds. Sounds are going to, or is what's going to spark the revolution. You know what I mean? The sounds. And we got our thumbs on the pulse, you dig? So come get some. If you were bad enough, take some, you did? Come get some. That's what it is. Gypsies, tramps, and pimps. You know, and the same post on the same grind, we do have day-to-day jobs. You know what I mean? Don't get it twisted, youngsters out there, thinking you're just going to jump in the game and get your toes wet and walk on water. You know what I'm saying? It ain't going to happen that way because you got a lot of people walking ahead of you. So get your 9-to-5 grind on. You know what I'm saying? Find what's good to you, what fits your personality, and you can still be you and maintain and do that, man. You know what I'm saying? Pay them bills. Get that rent, do all that, you know what I mean? But at the same time, pursue your life mission, which is should be this music, man. Because like I said, music, entertainment, anything in that nature, anything where you can influence another to do something positive, that's what you need to be doing.
The word pimp, man, it could be anything. It don't necessarily mean that you're pimping somebody on the streets. It's just all about what you know. Utilize the things that you know, and you make money off of it, you pimp it. You see what I'm saying? If it's women, if it's selling cars, if it's any type of livelihood that's bringing some type of income into your house, you know what I'm saying, to support your family. You know, anything could be pimping, you know what I'm saying? It don't necessarily mean women, so we're going to clear all that stuff up, you know, for y'all cats that really want to know. That pimping don't mean that you pimping women. It could be you could pimping yourself. You could be sitting there pimping a job that you work at to make that money. You know what I'm saying? It could be the record industry. It could be music. It could be anything that you possibly can make income off of. Well, that's what I do. I'll pimp the music industry. As far as, you know, I do hydroponics, I'm in the food industry, I do that. As well as I'm into a lot of other things that are very creative and that are real lucrative in the money. I mean, so it all depends. Like I said, these are the things that I use to support my family. These are the things that I teach my family. You know what I'm saying? Always strive. Never, when you fall back, learn how to pick yourself up. If you don't pick yourself up, you're going to drown. You know what I'm saying? This is real life out there. There's a lot of trials and tribulations that you got to go through. And as a pimp, you got to learn how to be strong. You got to learn how to stand on your own, too. You know what I'm saying? Without that, it's nothing. Pretty much everything you can get your hands on, I'm into it. Jazz, funk, hip-hop, you know, I'm eclectic when it comes to music. Music is something that you feel when it comes to creating music. I just feel it. And when I feel it, I just run with it. I create it, and whatever, you know, the Lord allows it to come out, then that's what I do. GTP is just about hardcore funk, it's about pop, it's about everything, you know what I'm saying? But it's all about original music, stuff that, you know, you never heard before.
For me personally, what motivates me right now is also my two brothers, man, my brothers in verse. It's almost like we should be called BIV, brothers in verse, because, like I said, if you're out there struggling, some people move here thinking, oh, because I got a great body, I got a pretty face and a great voice, they're going to walk down Hollywood Boulevard, and then next week they're at the Academy Awards. It's not like that. It's like we do hustle, we grind. We look great doing it because a true artist is clever. You have to fake it till you make it. Because I was taught, if you want to be a billionaire, you hang around billionaires. If you want to be a star, you got to think like a star, and you got to hang around stars. And we've been blessed to be, from the MTV Awards to American Music Awards, to knowing some of the most influential people of all time. And I'm going to introduce you to what drives me every day. But first, because I need to look great, I need to slip into this. Now follow me. Because what drives me, the person who has influenced me the most as far as being a star, you think it would be my father, my family? It's this woman right here. This woman.
That looks like Jody Watley.
This is Jody Watley. I was fortunate enough to meet Jody Watley a few years ago, and she came up to me and basically told me, in the famous words of her, never stop being you. Everybody in music needs something. And Jody, I'm just glad that God led you to me because I admire you so much.
I wrote Oprah a 3-page letter letting her know this woman deserved to be there to have those helpers there. Because this is greatness. This is greatness.
That's
always.
That's
the song. But Gypsies, Traps, and Pimps, I am Gypsy. Gypsy is just who I am. Gypsy, God, why, prosperity, salvation, why not? That's what moves me. That's what moves any gypsy out there who, you know, is inspiring today. Basically what it is, my philosophy, what keeps me going is just positive energy. I am at zero balance. I bring forth the positive energy anywhere I go, and people swarm to it. Gypsies, we walk with a positive perception all the time. You know what I mean? When you hear me in my songs or wherever you say, have yourself a gypsy day, that means when you go to sleep, you're truly awake. When you go to sleep, you're thinking about what you want to happen in the next day. So when you wake up in this dream world, in this perception, you should be having a gypsy day if you're focusing right, if you're focusing your thoughts right and you're aligning yourself right. Having fun, you know what I mean? It's not about crucifying yourself and all being all sheltered and bottled up. No, that's not the way of the gypsy, you know what I mean? We move, we do what we like, we do what comes natural to us, which is to have a good time, spread positive energy, and stay on the grind. It's about making a way. Give me something. Give me nothing and I'll produce something. That's what I should say. You can give me a box of trinkets that you thought were old and ragged and tattered and you had no use for them, and I guarantee you I'll bring you some platinum back. That's what a gypsy do. Musically, I like to produce a lot of tracks. You know what I mean? I think I have my pulse, my finger on the pulse of the industry right now. I can be your Dre. I can be your Neptunes. I can be your Timbaland, any of those cats. That's what Gypsy can morph into, any of those cats when it comes to sound. But I've learned to develop my own sound, Gypsy Track. Producer of the Year is coming soon, you know what I mean? Everybody from Mary J. Blige to Erykah Badu and a lot of people in the industry have heard stuff from the Gypsy, and they're looking to purchase certain things, you know what I mean? Which is good right now because, like you said, we are up and coming, we are on the grind, and you got to keep plugging in every manner, you know what I mean? What I have to say to anybody up and coming, you know what I mean, that's inspiring to do what we do or just do you, you know what I mean? Is keep pushing and don't allow anybody to tell you to stop. Don't stop, period. Well, keep your circle tight, but keep it right. You know what I mean? It's like we work in a circle of three right now, and that's what it is, the Trinity. You know what I'm saying? Tri-stars. Y'all can't see it? Tri-star. You dig? That's what it is. It's about that Trinity. It's about getting that energy and blowing, exploding through the universe. You know what I mean? It's a new awakening, man. You know, we have people come and spark it. And I look at it like a traditional line for gypsies. And this is for gypsies. Gypsy traditional line. I'm going to break it down to you. Gypsy traditional line started with the man that created the first rock and roll song, which was Ike Turner, you know what I mean? Gypsy extraordinaire. Then it came to another man named Jimi Hendrix, who took it to a whole nother level. Seth Ford, and I think he was in London for a good 4 or 5 days and became a mega, mega star, you know what I mean, overnight. Then it went through a cat by the name of Sly from the Family Stone, which at the same time kind of spawned into this Parliament Funkadelic, which then created this Prince guy. And Prince, you know what I mean, just like, he took it and balled it up and then put it under a magnifying glass and blew it up into something called Purple Rain, which then brought you Andre 3000s, which brought, you know what I mean, a lot of other, their CeeLo's, and then comes along these cats, Gypsies, Tramps, and Pimps. We were all mixed up in the same time. It's just about the order that you get poured out onto the universe in, you know what I mean? And I'm privileged to have seen a lot of these cats, know a lot of these cats, and been touched by a lot of these cats. And given that little, torch, you know what I mean? They passed that torch, and here I am, standing, burning, flaming up, you know what I mean? It's like, they can't stop this energy, man. So that's what a gypsy is. Gypsy, God, why? Prosperity, salvation, why not? Now you know. This ain't never like, I ain't never. Come on. I see the Oreos down there. Those are going to be gone by the night. I guarantee you that. You know what I mean? He know he done messed up. We got Ben and... Who is this, James? Oh, see, yeah, we ain't struggling that bad. You know what I'm saying? That's rare though.
I don't know who he trying to fool, man. This cat that broke his bank and spent his car payment. Get some food so y'all can think you got.
What's up, Funksters and Funkettes? Once again, it's your Funk Ambassador Glass of GTP. Just coming to bring you one important message. I know it's wonderful to dream about being glamorous and famous and all of that stuff, but keep a job until you get where you're going. Because you can't look great and change. Hey, I'm on my way to being the Black Liberace, the new millennium, new soul. Big jewels, crazy shoes, crazy outfits. I'm trying to change clothes more than Diana Ross does. Because that's who I am. If you want to be a chew tramp, that's what you got to do. You got to look great, and you got to collect great jewelry. That's all I'm saying. Hey, think it, be it, live it, love it. Peace.
What we're doing is we're recording the live version of our debut CD, which is We Are Here. This is what we basically do before every show. This is our equipment, our rack mounts, all his bass stuff, his bass gear, his TT gear, generally my rig, and this is Ali's rig. Ali plays the bouzouki, the saz, as well as the traditional guitars. Why don't you explain about your amps that go with your instruments?
I have an acoustic amp over there that goes with my bouzouki. It's an acoustic instrument, made it electric, amplified a little bit. I have an electric saz right here. And that goes with a Fender right in the middle. And it has the frets in between frets, the F sharp half, and the Eastern scales. It's a little fretless towards the end. Of course, I have my Marshall cab and my Carbon head for my electric guitar.
Ali, what's your name and what band do you play?
My name is Ali Shayesta. I'm in the Siri Dial band. SDB for short, but I prefer Siri Dial band. It gets makes a point, you know. Doing a little tuning.
I'm Siri Dial. I'm in the Siri Dial band. We've been a band for about 6 years now. We started in Ohio. We played all of Ohio. I was born in Los Angeles, California. Both my parents are jazz musicians, so I come from music. My whole band comes from music. My drummer, Terrence Irvin, has been playing drums basically since he was 3 years old. He started on the pots and pans. My bass player's been playing bass since he was 9. That's when he got his first bass. And my guitar player, saz, bouzouki, oud player, he's been playing since he was 10 years old. So all of us have put in cumulatively about 120 years into this. If you add it all up and put it together, that's a long time. LA's been pretty much the toughest audience because there's so many bands here, there's so many people doing their things, there's so much talent. We released a record, and it's released right now in Japan, and what we're doing now is a live version of the We Are Here CD. Basically, it's a pretty tense thing to do because you have to play your whole record without making any mistakes, or let's say any perceived mistakes, because music isn't flawless in its nature. The perfection is in how it comes together. Our sound, we use a lot of different words. We are a rock band because we use guitars, but we also have a very world sound. It's a before the show thing, so I'm talking to you guys and I'm kind of like thinking, you know, what do I have to do next? Do I have to sound check? You know, do I have to get my mic? We gotta get all of our stuff together. We have to get our sound together. We have to get our balance and get the room tight, and we have to have a ritual, which is where how we come together and calm down and do what we do to go there. Siri Dial means great mercy and compassion. The song that is 15 in Japan is a song called Peace. But why don't you come back with me back here and you can see what really goes on. Really nice people. Say hello to the people. People say hello.
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 How's it going?
What's up?
We can't do what we do without people. Come in and shut the door.
sound checking.
Oh, I don't care. Scorpio's fine with me.
What?
We're talking about what we're vocally sound checking.
What is the sound? You don't know yet?
It's not, nothing's coming out.
Is your mic on?
No. That might help if the mic gets turned on, huh?
Waiting on Ollie.
I'm actually ready.
I'm ready too.
Let's see, the music's been it's been over 6 years since the music's been transformed and into what it is today. Been toured across the country and ended up doing a CD in Seattle, actually. Then we moved from Seattle once the CD was done and made a home base here in California. And that particular time, we ran across a fantastic drummer, T.T. Urban.
I'm Terrence T.T. Urban, also known as the guy who barely speaks. And yeah, that's me. I'm the drummer, percussionist, maker of odd sounds. Other than the barking, that's him.
Listen, my name is Ollie. Ollie Shiesta. I play the guitar, but I play a whole bunch of other instruments. I play the instrument bouzoukis from Greece. I play the Turkish saz, the Arabic oud, the Persian setar, electric guitar, and I play with myself. Yeah. Yes. Yes. I'm the newest member in the band, but it feels like we've been together for a long time because these guys fuck with me all day long, and I guess they're my little brothers and sisters. So.
You gotta break you in.
Yeah. And here's Siri D.
I'm Siri D. They like to call me Siri.
Siri D once again.
Siri D.
I like that.
These are my babies. I never speak mean to them. I never demand anything from them. I'm always so nice in rehearsals. Every day. If they're late, who cares? If they miss a hit,
yeah, please play this back.
It's only music. Things in LA weren't doing so good. And, I really wanted to do my music with the message, but I was having a hard time being able to do that because most people wanted to, have me do tracks and do these, just put me in what they thought I was as opposed to who I know I am. And so my friend was doing the Master P Little Romeo tour, and she said, well, Siri, why don't you come out to Ohio and do the Midwest leg for me and, sing backgrounds. And I thought, well, okay, it's a job and it's music, so I'll do it. So I get out there, but I bring my music, and the deal that I made was I'll do that if that production team put me up in the studio in between the shows. So they agreed to that. So I did that tour with my friend and started recording at a studio called Rephrase? Yeah, Rephrase Studios. And I met an engineer out there, and we decided that we wanted to start a band. And then we went on the hunt, and the first stop was Rob Bass. We went to this place called Chuck's Jazz Lab, and in search, because that's where we heard the best musicians were. It's this old dumpy dive where all the best musicians in Dayton play. And so we hustled on down there, and we met a guitar player named Don Taylor. And he's like 7 foot tall. He's like, hey, come back to my house, we'll jam out some music. And we were like, okay, cool. So we go to his house and we're jamming out the music and we're listening and he's playing and we're all doing our thing. And then all of a sudden, Robba, it's 7 in the morning by this time. All of a sudden, Robba comes down the stairs and just got out of the shower, getting ready to go to work. And Dante, his brother, introduces him.
Actually, you were saying like you were looking for a bass player too.
I said, we're looking for a bass player. And he goes, I play bass.
Well, she gave me 3 of her songs that she was working on, and I took them with me and I listened to them. I was like, wow, she's a very beautiful girl, but can she sing? And I was listening to the tracks, and I was like, whoa, she can sing too. Wow, that's awesome. So as soon as I got back home, we went straight to work on the songs. And
wrote 3 songs the first day.
The first day we wrote 3 of the songs that's on the CD. At that point, we kept writing songs, and then at that point we had
a catalog of originals, and then we went to Seattle to record them. And we went there and we finished the CD, and then we decided to come to
LA. This time we didn't have a drummer.
Right.
We had a drum machine.
Drum machine. What about when I was auditioning drummers and it was a guy I was auditioning when T knocked on the door?
Yeah,
and
that's
I was
true.
Like, this guy was like, oh, I was like, okay, wait a minute, let me check T out. And as soon as he started playing, stuff started vibrating off of the fireplace, car alarms started setting off outside. It was like, yeah, he's a hard hitter. That's what we need.
It was instant. It was instant. Ali, go ahead.
Well, this is a good friend of theirs found me on Craigslist. I was
he was in New York at the time.
Yeah, New York, San Francisco. I just looking for the band. I guess they'd audition a whole bunch of guitar players and I was in New York. I was on for whatever reason and they said, "Oh, when are you coming back?" I said, "I don't know, I'll be back Thursday. Can we do it Friday?" They go, "Yeah." And I go, "Great, these guys are very flexible." So I showed up and they'd waited for me and I plugged in and the funny thing is it's like we clicked right there and then, and she she's so aggressive, you know, even in an audition. She goes, "Okay, when can you start?"
But it's just something that you know when you know, and that's it. And then the personalities usually get along and then you really get to know each other, and we're getting ready to get on the road together and be on a bus. Oh God. Come on in. Let's get down here. Let's go do what we do. This is what we do.
So this is the live version of the We Are Here, but most of the time when we gig out, what we do is our newer stuff. So this is kind of like a revisiting, and it's a lot of fun for us. So we're just about to do SDB. So any of you feel free to sing along with it, because that's what this is. It's a singy song, song along. All right.
Hopefully you can hear me.
It's a singy song, song along.
Hopefully I'll get to that point.
Nice.
Oh,
just a fan. Tell him I'm just a fan of Siri. You know, the rock feeling, I feel like, you know, because they're black, they're bringing the soul into the rock. You know, so it's like the old school, like Elvis meets Louis Armstrong meets, you know, Duke Ellington meets Cab Calloway. You know, nice. I get that feel. You know, I'm sure you guys get that same feel too. This is like a soul Erykah Badu type of thing, you know. And they're going to over that to, you know, to across the seas. It's going to be a real test of time. You see what I'm saying?
Hey, good evening. Yeah, I'm glad to be here. I guess we're on. But I'm D.W. Dewey Bonner, and I'm a manager for the business, and I'm the managing director of the new Junior Records. But what's happening, I'm here about Siri Dow and her band. And I've known Siri for over 10 years. And I've seen her develop, grow, and I see this intensity and excitement in this band. I agree with what the young man just said, that it's a fusion of soul, rock, and all the elements, melodic, you know, that we like to hear today in the music industry. And I wish him the best, and I love Siri, and that's why I'm here.
Best one. I ate all the vegetables.
Arigato. Muchas gracias. Everything. Merci beaucoup. We love you. Thank you so much. God bless you all.
Hey, hi, this is Siri D again. We just finished the show, winding down. Our message, JP, our message,
that
is peace, and that it is achievable. That's what it is. That's what we're about. That's what we want to bring. That's the message we want to bring forward with our music. And having fun with it.
And if you don't accept it, we'll kick your ass.
That's right. Exactly. Basically, for those of you chasing the dream, don't chase it. Just do it. Get up every day. Make it happen. Live it. Be it. Discipline. And be about something.
Or not discipline. Just flow. Just be real.
Be real. Definitely be you. But whatever you do, make it you. If you're chasing the dream, make sure that your dream is worthy to share with everybody.
Enjoy it.
Enjoy it. And let others enjoy it. And you enjoy it. And the world will be a better place. You can do it. I know you can. Peace out, babies. Peace. That's who we are.
Peace.